All right, so pursuing peace and changing our outlook on the biggie, also known as misplaced expectations. So surveys show that 8 out of 10 Americans are stressed and they're troubled. And I can see why, because of all of the texting and the cell phones and everything else. I mean, don't you just feel like that one technology can totally stress us out? But there's so much more to 8 out of 10 Americans being stressed out and having no peace. Over the last 4 months, I've actually went around and asked countless people this one question. And I would like for you to answer this question as well. The question that I've asked countless people, men, women, single, pastors, people in ministry, people in the world, this one question. And the question is, in 10 words or less, what causes you personally to have a lack of peace? And I would like for you to just to quickly write it down. You know exactly what causes you to have a lack of peace. Because I want you to really be thinking about this. It's important that we think about it. And another thing that's pretty awesome is that, you know what's so fun? Is that each person I asked that question to, it gave us such a deep opportunity to have a heart-to-heart. And so it was such a blessing. But the next question I asked them is, how do you pursue peace when you are gripped with a lack of peace personally and practically? You see, whenever I was a teenager, I decided that because I was in home ec and I was learning how to cook, that I was going to go home one day. I was home all alone. I'm an only child. And I decided that I was going to make donuts for my dad. My dad's a police officer. I mean, what else do you do but make donuts for police officers, right? So I was super excited about this. And so I was at home and I was making donuts. Well, I had no idea because in home ec, I had not had the opportunity to learn this particular thing. And that is, if you have oil too hot, it actually can catch on fire. And so the pan was on fire and I thought, oh no, how do you put fire out but water? And so I had the pan, it had a flame, and I had the water on high, and so I flung it over the water and the whole entire thing exploded. And now I am standing in the kitchen and everything, you know, it looks like it's up in flames. I have caught the kitchen on fire. And so I thought to myself, oh no, I have no idea why the water didn't put that fire out. So I thought, well, the first time didn't work, let's try it again. And so I did it again. I had the water and I dumped water on it and another explosion. And basically, I was burning down the house. I was burning down the kitchen. There was fire. There was all this stuff. And then I noticed that there was this flour. And so what I did is I just grabbed the flour, and I started just flinging it all over the kitchen. And I was completely in a panic. And I thought this was not the way that I thought this donut making was going to go. But I had no peace at that moment, because as I sat there and anticipated my mom coming home, I had no peace. And my misplaced expectation began to do her work. She began to tell me, Tammy, you are the biggest loser. Your mom is going to yell at you. She's going to be mad at you. She's never going to trust you again to ever cook anything in the kitchen. After all, this is a brand new house that your mom and dad had saved to have built. And now you have ruined everything. Look at you. Look what a loser you are. And I sat there and agreed with her. And fear gripped my heart. And as soon as I heard my mom pull into the driveway, I just thought, I'm just going to go out there and take the blows, because my mom is going to just give me a good one. And so I just marched right out there and I said, Mom, I caught the kitchen on fire. And my mom surprised not only me, but she also surprised misplaced expectation. And you know what my mom said to me? She said, Tam, you are the only girl I have. Are you okay? What? Yeah, I'm okay. And I was waiting for the next blow. And all she did was say, we can replace things, but we cannot replace you. That day, I learned a very, very valuable lesson. And the lesson I learned was, my mom valued me more than she valued her own brand new house. And, you know, whenever we're young mommies, we have to realize that our little kids, they're going to stain our brand new carpet. Our little kids, they're going to spit up on our brand new dress and make us even stink a little. Our kids, they're going to ruin the seats and the furniture in our house. But with every single situation us moms have, this one opportunity, and that opportunity is when our kids make mistakes, like I made the biggest mistake. I would almost burn our house completely down. I made a mistake. My mom could have just gave me a good one. We have opportunities to say our kids' hearts are more valuable than our stuff. Because you see, whenever we have misplaced expectations of living in a perfect world, we can throw things at people. Like, you know, Ingalil said, we want to control people's lives. We know what's best for them, and yet we don't know what's best for them. And so I was so blessed that my mom responded like that to me. As a matter of fact, the thing that's so cool about my mom, and she's here tonight, which I'm so thankful, she drove all the way up from Twin Falls, is that my mom has been my greatest cheerleader my whole entire life. My mom has never tried to change me and make me into something that I'm not. If I ended up with C's to her, she's like, if you did the best you can, that's all that matters. So, you know, I kind of grew up with this, in a sense, view on life that I'm loved. I am loved, and life is going to be okay. But as you kind of go through life, there's other situations that can come into our life. There are situations that can rob us of our peace. There are situations that can come into our life and cause us to have anxiety. There's opportunities where frustration and anger and betrayal can try to poison our mind. And when those things come knocking at our door, what do we do? We do what we know best, and that is we turn off the world. We turn off misexpectation, and we turn to Jesus, because Jesus is our rock. He and he alone has the answers. And so I am so excited to expose misplaced expectations tonight, because if we can expose her, ladies, we don't have to walk around fearful. We don't have to walk around listening to her. As a matter of fact, it takes a while to fire her. And I'm here to tell you, I am on the rampage to fire this girl. And it's hard. And I tell you, you have to be purposeful to fire this girl, because she always wants to dominate the theme park of our mind. And, you know, we all have a theme. Our theme is when life changes. And she's always trying to dominate the theme park of our life in a place that she brings the Jurassic Park moment. Don't you feel? It's like Jurassic Park, and you're just sitting there, oh my. And we believe these misplaced expectations that start in our brain. And so this verse means so much to me. The verse that is our theme verse, the Bible tells us in Psalm 62, 5 and 6, my soul waits silently for God alone, for my expectation is from him. He only is my rock and my salvation. He is my defense. I shall not be moved. And Mrs. Misplaced Expectation, she brings disappointment. She brings fear, disillusionment at the end of every day, and she laughs in our face. But you see, life is a journey, and it's less about what you do and more about who you are becoming as you do it. Wait silently for God alone, for my expectation is from him. Practically, let me explain with a picture. People are a lot like an iceberg. There are two components. What you see above the waterline is 10%, and what you see below the waterline is 90%. Our character is critical to affect our children, our grandchildren, our husbands, our girlfriends. It's critical. Our character is critical. But many times in the situation of the iceberg, all we see in each other is what we do. And then we kind of, in a sense, that is your identity, what you do. So what do you do? What is your skill set? Are you the best cook ever and you're just looking for new recipes and you're like, this is so much fun? Are you the best decorator? Maybe you run your own business. Maybe you're brilliant. Maybe you're smart. Maybe you're a singer. Maybe you're an incredible organizer. You can go into a messy closet, and within moments, it is like, yeah. But you know what, ladies? We are so much more than what we do. We have this opportunity to develop our character. And we should want to grow, because if we're not growing, we're dying. You know, just like you see a little plant, and if you just stop watering it, pretty soon it just like shrivels up. And then it just becomes this dead thing sitting over there. So we should want to grow all the time, because it makes life exciting. And so let me ask you this. Who are you? Are you honest? Are you dedicated? Are you compassionate? Or are you dishonest? Are you lazy? Are you rude? Are you stubborn? What part of the iceberg sinks a ship? What? It's the part that's underneath, because they can't see it. So that, you know, the Titanic story, it was the iceberg that sunk this ship. And Mrs. Misplaced Expectation wants to completely sink our ships. She wants us to shrink us back into a corner of fear. She wants us to try to control our families to a place where they want to shrink back and think, who are you? She is on the rampage all the time. But, you know, over the last 4 months, whenever I ask countless people, what is the one question, what causes you to have a lack of peace? You know, it was so fascinating, because whether I was asking young women or married women or men, this is the list that they gave me. They said, what causes me to have a lack of peace is self-focus, abundance of expectations. Being a people pleaser causes me to have a lack of peace. Holding on to hurts causes me to have a lack of peace. Relational conflict, pressure to be perfect causes me to have a lack of peace. Fearful of the future causes me to have a lack of peace. Not seeking the Lord first causes me to have a lack of peace. And being overly busy causes me to have a lack of peace. Does anybody relate to any of these? Yes. Maybe all 9 of them? But I want to tell you that there is one link that cracks the combination to this list that causes people to have a lack of peace. The big E, also known as Mrs. Misplaced Expectation, because this one link is basically the figment of our imagination. It all starts in our mind. This one common link, a link means two things that connect with one another when one thing affects the other. And I think that we can crack this combination if we really hone in on this and really go about life looking whenever we have this different situation where you can tell that you have actually, you have this figment of your imagination and you are imagining something in your mind. And then you think, okay, this is going to happen. You assume this is going to happen. And then you get yourself all worked up as almost if it was real. But that causes us to have a lack of peace. And so if we can actually take every thought captive and think about this, it will change your life. You will be free. Because over the last probably 7 years, I have been looking at this verse, and I've been looking at every opportunity to apply the theme verse to my life and removing my own misplaced expectations in my mind. And I have been looking for the opportunity to get my expectations from God and God alone. And it has changed my mind. Now, let me tell you, it takes a while to get into this new found rhythm, because a bad habit, I mean, we start this misplaced expectation when we're little. I mean, look at me. I was a teenager. I wasn't even saved, and I was already sitting there looking at the opportunity to have low expectations of my mom. And in reality, I was fretting. I was upset. I was crying. For what reason? For no reason at all. Because misplaced expectation wants to burn up our minds. She wants to dominate. She wants to control. But the biggie, it says, misexpectations, high or low, we put on ourselves, on other people or circumstance, they can dominate our life. And even when we look in the Bible, do you remember Martha? Martha even had her own expectations of Jesus. Do you remember that? And she said, if you would have been here, my brother would have not died. He would still be alive. And so many times we think it's all about our timing and the way that God should answer our prayers. Even, you know, Martha, it was all about her timing and how she felt like Jesus should answer her prayers. And she had these expectations. One of the things I want to share with you is that for years I operated out of a place of fear, complete fear. And the reason that I operated out of fear is because I had low expectations of everybody around me. I felt like I was never good enough for anything. I never even wanted to have new friendships because I knew that as soon as I would even try to have a new friendship, that friend wouldn't think that I had a good enough personality, that I wasn't smart enough, that I wasn't this enough, that I wasn't that enough, that I wasn't enough. And so it kind of backed me into a corner, and I thought, I don't even need to worry about this because why bother? I had low expectations. I even had low expectations of ever speaking in front of anybody. I'd always get these phone calls, people saying, hey, Tammy, can you come and like share, you know, about Hilden Set Free? And instantly I would say no. And this is why I would say no, because I knew as soon as I stood up to share, my Mrs. Low Expectations would look out there and I might see Roxanne Boyle or I'd see Julie and they would look at each other and they'd be like, oh no, Tammy's here speaking, let's run. And that's what I actually thought would happen. And you can see how crazy these misplaced expectations can dominate our life, and we're afraid. We're afraid of assuming that this is reality, and in many cases, it's not reality. And even if they did get up and run, so what? It's kind of like, well, I guess if God didn't want to speak to them, then if that's his expectation, we can accept it. We don't even have to be afraid of making mistakes. We don't have to be afraid of stepping out if God, you know, is asking us to do something. Because the Bible tells us in Proverbs 14:12, there is a way that appears to be right, but in the end it leads to death. So the big E, expectations are no more than premeditated resentment leading to a dominating force of less peace, less love, more fear, pressure to control, more anger, and more hurt. When we put unrealistic expectations on others, it's premeditated resentment, meaning when someone fails us, we are preparing ourselves for resentment, which creates a lifelong thing of strongholds and bondage. But the Bible tells us in Hebrews 12, 14, and 15, pursue peace with all people and holiness, without which no one will see the Lord, looking carefully lest anyone fall short of the grace of God, lest any root of bitterness spring up, cause trouble, and by this many become defiled. And have you ever noticed that misplaced expectation, they're a lot like popcorn? You know, like you eat one, and then you want to eat another one. And then you eat one, and then you eat another one. And then pretty soon, your whole life is about these expectations. And you just keep on eating them and eating them and eating them, and you actually have no peace. No peace at all. And that is exactly the way I lived for years and years and years and years and years. And it's not very much fun. Is there anybody here that eats misplaced expectations? All right. Well, I am amongst, you know, people that are understanding. There only was probably about 10 hands in here. And so I'm thinking that all of you don't need this message because you already have it all under control and you never have any kind of figment of your imagination just running wild. So praise the Lord. But let me just give you a few practical examples of ways that women have changed their outlook on expectations. I've gathered these up from real people. There's a little gal who works in a Christian coffee shop. And so every day she would go to work, she had her misplaced expectations that her boss should be really friendly, should engage more in conversation with her, should really just be more godlike. And she was going to work, and as this was going on, she started having this premeditated resentment. And she started looking at her boss like, yeah, you think you're a Christian, but you really aren't, because look at you, you know, like you're not very friendly. And it really started to affect her work. And then she decided that she was going to seek the Lord and find out why was she acting like this. You see, she was actually believing the lies of misplaced expectations. And so she decided that with the Lord's help, that she was going to begin to get all of her expectations from God. And so she prayed and said, God, what are your expectations? And so God ministered to her heart, why don't you pick 5 things that you're thankful for your boss? Why don't you start looking at the things you're thankful for? And so as she did, she was amazed because now she goes to work because she changed her outlook on Mrs. E or Mrs. Expectations. And now she goes to work and she thinks, wow, my boss is so amazing. She does everything she can that whenever we ask for time off, she works so hard to give us time off. And she notices that the workplace is so organized that she works overtime to try to make everything clean and orderly. You see, whenever we get our expectations from God, it's amazing how it changes our outlook, isn't it? And that premeditated resentment flies out the window. And also another thing that's so amazing is that God becomes our rock and he stabilizes our thinking. And when love begins, when expectations end. And so another example is a little gal who is a pastor's wife. And so her and her husband, they were at a retreat. And as they were at this retreat, she started looking around. Oh, I noticed that so-and-so's in her mind, Mrs. Expectations, yeah, I noticed that they're holding their wife's hand. Yeah. Yep. Mm-hmm. He's holding her hand too. Jeez. I wonder when my husband's going to hold my hand. So she just sat there, and as worship was going, she started stewing, and that premeditated resentment just started to boil. So by the time the whole message was over, they headed back to their room, and they were hanging out. She's all pouty, and she's mad, and he said, Kath, what's wrong? Nothing. Kath, we're not leaving this room until you tell me what is wrong. He said, how did I get myself into trouble? All we were doing is worshiping the Lord. Well, I noticed that all these different guys were holding their wife's hand, but you didn't even try to even make an effort to hold my hand. And he said, Kath, if you want to hold my hand, just grab it. We've been married for 25 years. It's yours. And so that is what Mrs. misplaced expectation does to us. We get ourselves so upset that we can't even live in the moment to enjoy our husbands. And so then she went to the Lord and said, God, how can I get my expectations from you? And God ministered to her heart, why don't you just start praying the simple prayer? God, help me be the wife that my husband needs. Because every single husband in this room that you're married to, they're all fearfully and wonderfully made. There's not one alike. For me, there's no one like Rick Brown. And so I can pray every day and say, God, will you help me to be the wife that Rick needs for that day? And you know, God, he can put his expectations, he can show you, and he can help you know what to do and actually be thankful. And so another example, and then we're going to keep on moving on, is that there's a little gal, and she was in the Bible college. And so as she was at this Bible college, she had this expectation that all of the girls in her dorm would know how to clean the kitchen. She just assumed this. Mrs. Expectation said, you know, all these girls should know how to clean a kitchen by now. And so she was waiting, and she kept looking at them, and she kept wondering, and when are they going to get their act together? And so premeditated resentments began to boil, and there became a flame, and she was upset. And at the end of her time at the Bible college, she thought to herself, what is the matter with me? And the thing that she said to me was it completely destroyed her heart to think that all she was focused on was the dirty dishes. And in reality, she missed out on all of the cool, amazing spiritual things that God was actually doing in people's hearts because she had her eyes on the wrong thing. And so it's so crucial that we don't just sit around and eat this popcorn of premeditated resentment. So we need to cross out the E, no more premeditated resentment. And I want to share with you that whenever you remove this expectation that consumes our mind and you remove premeditated resentment, you know what happens? It's the shortcut. And the reason I tell you it's the shortcut is because you don't even have to process. You don't even have to process through forgiving because there's nothing to forgive. Because you don't even have any expectations of that person to begin with. And so it's basically the shortcut. And who doesn't want a shortcut? I mean, how many of you love being resentful towards somebody, and then when you see them, you're upset with them, and you're angry, and now you have to work through the process of forgiving them? How many love that process? All of you do? No one's raising your hand, so I'm assuming that you don't like that process. And so this is the shortcut. If we just get our expectations from God and we just ask God, then we don't have to work through this whole entire thing. And it causes us to have peace. And I just love that. And so, okay. We are going to have to really speed this up because we're almost out of time. All right. So the big E. My soul waits silently for God alone, for my expectation is from him. He only is my rock and my salvation. He is my defense, and I shall not be moved. The Lord desires for us to have character of peace inside of us. And I'm just going to whirl all the way through to almost the end. All right. So life is a journey. It's less about what you do and more about who you are becoming as you do it. So the Bible tells us in Romans 14:19, so then we pursue the things which make for peace and the building up of one another. When we build up those that we love, we build up our husbands and we build up our children and we build up our friends. And we desire to pursue peace. How do we pursue peace when at times we can be gripped with a lack of peace? The Bible tells us in Isaiah 26:3, you will keep in perfect peace all who trust in you and all whose thoughts are fixed on you. When God becomes our focal point, and we put all of our expectations on him, and we allow him, we integrate him into our every life, into our every moment, into our every detail. And, you know, the way that I began to change this whole entire wrong thinking was every morning, I actually wrote out this verse, Psalms 62, 5 and 6. And I wrote it out, and then I put it in my Bible. And every morning before I read my Bible, I actually read this verse. And as I read it, I'm like, okay, God, my soul is going to wait silently for you alone. And I want my expectation to be from you. Because whenever I get my expectation from you and you tell me what to do through the day and how to have the right attitude and how to respond in the right way, what happens is that he does become our rock. He does become our salvation. He is our defense. And you know what happens? We shall not be moved by all of our emotions. And we don't let Mrs. Expectation take over our life. We are actually putting her to death, and we are actually allowing our emotions and our thoughts to become more stabilized. It takes time, and the very moment I feel fearful, I know immediately I have either a high or a low expectation of about what's going to happen in that moment. Or if I feel like a weird attitude towards somebody, it's because I've either had a high or low expectation of what that person should do or shouldn't do. And so you can see immediately, you can hone in on this. And the more that you practice it and the more that you do it and the more that you are getting your expectations from God, the more freedom you're going to feel. And the thing that's so great is that whenever we get our expectations from the Lord, and your steps will be steady and sure, for he is our rock. And we don't have to burn down our relationships. You know, just like how I caught the house on fire, we don't have to burn up our relationships. We don't have to burn up the relationships that we experience in our church body. We don't have to let the relationships with mother-in-law and daughter-in-laws get burned up. We don't have to let the marriages get burned up with expectations. We don't have to let mother and daughter relationships burn up because of expectations. And so it's really important that if we want freedom, we actually have to go after it with the Lord and not just sit back and just let misplaced expectations dominate our life. And the thing that is so amazing when we do this is that our husbands get closer to us. Our children become closer to us. Our friends become closer to us. And you know why? It's because they feel safe with us. They feel safe that there's not judgment or these expectations, or these offenses, or misunderstandings. Because when you're with somebody, we can just enjoy them in the moment for whoever they are. Even if you have somebody in your life that doesn't even know Christ, and they are having a hard time, they've hit rock bottom, and maybe they're alcoholics. We don't have to have this misplaced expectation that they should be these amazing, godly people that have their act together. What we can do is we can just love them in the moment, because that's what God has called us to do. He has called us to love. And then he's called us to pray. And as we pray, we can just hand it over to him and let him sort out all the details in a person's life. We don't have to try to control it or manipulate it or try to make it happen. We can trust God. Because love begins when expectations end. I want to close with this one story. There was a man, and his wife ended up with dementia. And so every day he would go to the rest home. And as he would go there, he would learn how to do pedicures and manicures and how to do her hair. And he would show up there every single day just to spend time with her. And so the nurses noticed this, and the nurses thought, wow, I mean, we have never seen anything like this before. And so they went to this man, and they said, you know what, we notice that you're here all the time, and you really need a vacation. And, you know, we know your wife so well. We will take care of her. We're gonna bathe her, and we're going to do her hair. We're going to put her clothes on. You just go out, and you get yourself a life. You know, just go hang out, relax. You know, after all, she doesn't even know who you are. And he looked at them, these nurses, and with big tears running down his face, he said, you don't understand. every day I wake up, I can't hardly wait to get here to be with my girl. And that is removing all expectations of what he thinks or she thinks somebody should accomplish, and putting more value on the person of who you're spending time with, because love begins when expectations end. And we can become so close to those that we love if we could just let it go and change our outlook and be thankful for who they are and enjoy the moment, enjoy the very moment of who you're with. And whenever you leave that person, don't go through the whole thing, oh no, I wonder if I said this wrong or that wrong, or I wonder if she took this wrong, or oh, I bet you anything, she's probably mad at me. And we let misplaced expectations burn up that relationship, because the next time you get with that girlfriend, what happens? You feel awkward, like, I know what you've been thinking about me. We need to fire that woman. I don't know, like, don't we? Are you girls ready to fire her? Well, every day I'm trying to do it. So you know what? You guys have your own mind, so you need to do it yourself, because I can't do it for you. But God can help us. And that's what's so amazing. God is able. He is able to accomplish what concerns us. He is able to help us. And so if you are serious, because it takes time and it takes a while, read this verse every single day and look for opportunities to actually apply it to your life and watch the freedom take over your mind.